right now. Pray that someone will be helped, will be made better. And most of all, if there's anyone here who may not know you for the pardon of their sins, may come to know you as their Lord and Savior. It's in your Son Jesus' name that we do pray. Amen.
Amen.
Amen. Giving all honor to God, it's indeed a privilege to stand before you once again. I wasn't expecting to stand here this morning. Pastor Scott called me or texted me and said that Jared got the whole house sick and he wasn't feeling too well, so he asked me to stand in. But you know, God has a funny way of making things work. God, I was studying, getting ready for my classes this coming week at ORU, and I thought to myself, I said, man, I haven't preached in a while. I hope the Lord allows me to preach sometime soon so I don't get too rusty. And Pastor Scott was going to preach this morning, you know, when God doesn't come when you expect him. And if he would have gave me more time to write a sermon, I would have said, when God comes earlier than you expect him. But it's indeed always a pleasure to stand before you and preach the word of God. If you would stand with me, and turn to the book of Judges, the second chapter. Judges, the second chapter. If you don't know, that is in the Old Testament. Right after the book of Joshua. Right before Ruth. Judges, the second chapter. And I'll be reading from the English Standard Version. Judges, second chapter, and we're going to read verses 6 through 10. When you have it, say amen. And it reads, when Joshua dismissed the people of Israel went each to his inheritance to take possession of the land. And the people served the Lord all the days of Joshua, and all the days of the elders who outlived Joshua, who had seen all the great work that the Lord had done for Israel. And Joshua, the son of Nun, the servant of the Lord, died at the age of 110 years. And they buried him within the boundaries of his inheritance in Timnath-Heres, in the hill country of Ephraim, north of the mountain of Gaash. And all the generation also were gathered to their fathers. And this is the key verse, verse 10b. And there arose another generation after them who did not know the Lord or the work that he had done for Israel. May the Lord have a blessing to the readers, the hearers, and the doers of his most holy and righteous word.
Amen.
Amen. And for a few moments this morning, I want to talk from the subject headed for self-destruction. Headed for self-destruction. 2004, the beginning of my senior year in high school, we had just came off losing in the semifinals to Northeast High School in Oklahoma City, in the semifinals of the state tournament in basketball. And I knew the outcome of season would be my last chance to play the game that I love. And any constructed, organized league. And so I wanted to make the most of my senior year in basketball. And we trained throughout the summer with some of my friends. We would go to the gym. We did everything that we could to prepare ourselves even more for our last season of basketball at Omega High School. But boy, did my senior season, it didn't go the way I thought it should go, and it didn't go the way that I planned it to go. We self-destructed so bad. You know, my basketball coach would always do something. After every game, he would always come and read stats. But there were two stats that he would always read after every game, and that was turnovers and missed free throws. No matter what happened in the game, the ref could have blown the call that cost us the game, but he would always come into the locker room reading those two stats, turnovers and missed free throws. He would always say, oh, you missed five free throws. If you would have made three, you would have won by one. You know, he would always do that. He was always saying, no matter what happened in the game, he would always show us that there was something that we did to ourselves that cost us from winning the game. He never blamed the referees. He never blamed the other team for a dirty play. He never blamed the coach. He never blamed the crowd. He always pointed back to the things that we did that cost us a win. But not only did he point to those things, so we had some on-the-court issues. We would self-destruct in those ways, but there were also some self-destruction off the court. We had major egos on our team. We had players who were our key players that we would feed them the ball more than anybody else, but there were some other players who felt like they should get the ball just as much. And so because they didn't get the ball as much, they wouldn't play as hard. They wouldn't do the things that they should have done on the court or off the court. We had a bunch of young players with us. We had probably about 15 sophomores and freshmen that would practice with us. And so during practice, they would be playing. They would be laughing. Even when the coach is trying to teach us something that is new that none of us has seen before, we had players who were playing around doing their own thing. So we had egos. We had people who wanted to play. We had people who didn't pay attention. We had a lot of self-destruction off of the court. We had a lot of self-inflicted wounds. And I'm sure that all of these things and all these factors changed what our coach wanted to do with us on the court. And so all of these things, from the egos to the people playing and not paying attention and even playing in the locker rooms before games, I'm sure all of that self-infliction caused us to have a season that we did not plan on having that year. Who needs enemies when you have yourselves? Opponents didn't have to work too hard to beat us because we were beating ourselves. What do you mean by self-inflicted wounds? Well, they what we call in sports, they call unforced turnovers. In other words, there is nothing that the other team did to you, but you did on yourself while you're trying to be fancy and show off for the girls in the crowds. You dribble the ball off your foot and it goes out of bounds. Self-inflicted wounds. When you're trying to throw a fancy pass and it goes over somebody's head and it goes out of bounds. Self-inflicted wounds. These are the kinds of things that were going on throughout the season, on and off the court. And so teams didn't have to work too hard to beat us because oftentimes we were beating ourselves. We were more dangerous to ourselves than other teams were dangerous to us. And if you think about it, oftentimes in life, there are many situations, if you think back on your life, and you can sit back and say, you know what, I was dangerous to myself. I put myself in a lot of bad situations. I could have avoided, yes, and you cried and you weeped and you got mad about things didn't go your way, but you probably didn't say that it was your fault. You probably tried to blame somebody else. It's like what children do at school when you confront them about a situation. The first thing they do is say, well, Johnny did it too. Or, well, Johnny made me do it. She made me mad. He made me mad. And all of these other things. So that's one thing how we, when we self-inflict, we try to blame it on somebody else. And if not that, we recognize our problems, but we continue to do them anyway. Self-inflicted wounds. Or we would ask for forgiveness, wait a little while, see if the punishment is coming, and if it don't look like punishment is coming, we continue in the same foolishness that got us in the situations that we were in. Self-inflicted wounds. And that is a very dangerous game to play with God. And so as we are making a transition of power here in the United States, it seems as if our country is headed for self-destruction. It seems that mankind is pushing further and further away the ways of God to do that which it seems to be pleasing unto itself. We have marriage equality when God says that marriage is between man and woman. And the bad thing about it is you got even church people beating up on Kim Burrell because she decided to preach the truth. That's self-inflicted wounds of the church. And we have other things. We can talk about so many things in so many ways that the church is causing wounds on itself. It is dangerous to itself at times, but the church has what we call syncretized the secular with the sacred, and the book of Judges is going to show us what how dangerous that is and what will happen when you try to make the world, when you try to mix the world with the word. Self-inflicted wounds. When this is what's going to happen. Judges are going to show us that you're headed for self-destruction when you step outside of the realm of God. The book of Judges, it picks up where Joshua, or the book of Joshua left off. The book of Judges, it tells the story of the children of Israel after the death of Joshua to show the consequences of a religious apostasy and continued disobedience of Israel towards God. It begins to give the details of the conquest of Canaan, of the promised land that Joshua sent the children of Israel on as just before he passed away. And if we read Judges 2, verse 6 and 10, it says, when Joshua dismissed the people, it says that he sent them to take the inheritance. Each tribe had a place and the promised land to have of their own. He sent them out, and he says, and go and conquer it. Go and take it over. And it says that after that, soon after that, Joshua had died. Joshua, 110 years old, had died, and they put him in his inheritance. And it says, soon after he died, that those who grew up with him, his cousins, his brother, his kinsmen, those who was his age and a little bit older, they passed with him. And then it says in verse 10 that there came up another generation who knew not God. Who knew not God, nor any of the things, not one, did not know any of the things that God had did for them. So the question is, how do you go from a nation who worships God, who loves God, who knows God, to a nation who has no idea who he is, nor the things that he has done? That is a major turnaround. That is a major drop off. That is a drastic change in behavior and attitude. How do you go from knowing the Lord to not knowing who he is at all? But if you look at the text, we have to go back to Joshua 24, and we'll see that there was no transfer of power, so they self-destructed because there was no transfer of power. After Joshua gathered all the fathers in his farewell address, and he told them all the things that God had did for them, and the things that he would do for them, you see that Joshua passes, but there is no transfer of power. We don't know why Joshua didn't pick anybody to succeed him. The Bible is not clear on if he did or not, but the text doesn't say, so I have to assume that no one assumed the position of Joshua's leadership once he passed. And so there is a void left by Joshua when he dies. And so there is no transfer of power from Joshua to the next leader. And if you've been paying attention to politics, you'll see that President Obama and President-elect Trump have been talking about the necessity and the urgency and the importance of the transfer of power from one leader to the next. Because if it's a smooth transition, things can be kept in order. Yes, things may be done from one president to the next, from one leader to the next. But if you can transition smoothly, things will work out better than if you just leave them null and void. So Joshua doesn't transfer the power. And you see it in Exodus, because when Moses was getting ready to die, Moses took Joshua by the hand and said, Joshua, you are now the leader. The Lord has called me elsewhere. He says, I won't be able to, I've been able to see the promised land, but I won't be able to go for my disobedience. So Joshua, it is now up to you to lead the children of Israel into the promised land. And so there is no transfer of power. But it's not Joshua's fault, because when we see that Joshua did what he was supposed to do as a leader. But so not only did they self-destruct because of the no transfer of power, but they self-destructed because of lack of communication. Think about this. Joshua died at 110 years old. And it says that this generation, the people that he grew up with, outlived him, but then soon died after. So that means that there's about between 110 and 150 years old, these people lived. And not one of them told the story about how God, what God did for them. A whole generation grew up not knowing. You live for 110 years, 115, 120, 130, 40, 150 years, and you don't bother to tell nobody, to tell anybody what God has done for you? That is a problem. They didn't communicate the story in which God had did for them. Now, and you got to think about this in the Jewish culture. It was mandatory for fathers to teach their children at an early age all the things that God had did for them. They taught their children the law amongst other things. So they lived for 150 years. Their culture said that you are mandated to teach your children. But yet a whole generation grew up and didn't know anything about what God had did. That's a problem. And we, in the African American community, we know a little something about this because we always stress the need to know our history. We always stress and say, you need to know where you come from. You need to know your people. You need to know who you're related to. My mom used to, every time I would date somebody, my mom would, they would come over to the house and my mom played 21 questions. Who's your mama? Who's your daddy? Who you related to? Where they from? You know, and all these other questions. And I used to be embarrassed, like, mama, what are you doing? Like, why you keep asking all these crazy questions? No, she ain't related. I promise you, she's not related. And she was just like, man, and I finally asked her when I got off, mom, why would you always do that? Because she was like, you never know who you related to. And I wanted to make sure that if you knew who you were, that you were not dating somebody that you were related to. And it all ties back to knowing your history, knowing the things that your people have come through, knowing the things that your people have done and where you come from. Because if you know where you come from, you have a better understanding of how to move forward. And so there was an understanding in the Jewish community that I must teach my family about the ways of God. So that way, when things come up, I know exactly how to handle the situation. But they lived for 110, 150 years, and yet nobody told these children anything. And when you don't tell the story of how God has been good to you, you are headed for self-destruction. They did not communicate this story, but they did not communicate this story because they failed to listen to the warnings of Joshua. If you go back to chapter 24, if you stay in chapter 24, and when Joshua summons the leaders, he told them all the things that God had done. He said he brought you out of Egypt. He said he brought you through the wilderness, and he has kept you day and night, and he has kept you all through these years. And Joshua said he's been so good. He says that, he said, now you must choose ye this day whom ye will serve. Whether you will serve this God or you will serve the God of your forefathers on the other side of the river. But he says, as for me and my house, says I will serve the Lord. But he says, I can't choose for you. I made up in my mind. But as I get ready to leave you, I have to tell you that you must choose, because you can't choose this God and the God of the Canaanites and the gods of those in this valley and the God of the gods of those in this area. He said, because in the day that you do, he says, God will turn his back on you and he will cause you much pain. So Joshua told them what would happen in the very day that they would turn their backs on God and begin to worship other gods. And so Joshua said, choose ye this day whom ye will serve. But, and I know that seems kind of hard that God will turn his back on his people, but Jesus says that I am the way. Not a way, but I am the way, the truth, and the life. And no man comes through the Father but by me. And then he says in his great sermon on the Mount in Matthew 7, he says, wide is the gate that leads to destruction. And he says, many will find that road. He said, but narrow is the gate that leads to life, and not many will find it. And so even in this text, you can see that the words of Jesus are true, that if you don't choose the way of the Lord, it only leads to self-destruction. And so the Israelites, what did they do? Joshua said, if you don't take hold of God's hand, You're going to find yourself in a position that you don't want to be in. And so what did they do? Well, all you have to do is just flip the page and look over and Judges 1, and you'll see exactly what they did. For they started to self-destruct because they became contaminated. They, when Joshua died, and they went on, and in the beginning of Judges, it kind of retells the ending of the story of Joshua, where they went on to conquer the promised land in Canaan, and so they went on, and they were instructed by Joshua, when you get to your allotted land, you kill everything in it. Don't keep nothing, don't take nothing, and anything that has nothing to do with us, you destroy it. Now, those were the instructions of Joshua for all the leaders. And the leaders were working to go back to their own tribes and their own people and say, listen, when we get to where we're supposed to go, if they are not Jewish, if they are not a child of God, you kill them. You destroy it. You get rid of it. And so we'll see it leading up. And when you read chapters 1, you'll see that it started off right. By the time you get to verse 27 in chapter 1, it tells you all of the tribes that did not conquer the land in which they did before. It says that it says Manasseh, and it says Ephraim, and it says Zebulun, and it says Asher, and it says Naphtali, and it says that the tribes of Dan, when they got to their land, they did not do what Joshua had instructed. Instead, they laid with the enemy. They drank with the enemy. They ate with the enemy. They mingled with the enemy. And they did everything that they were not supposed to do. And then in chapter 2, the angel of the Lord says, what have you done? What have you done? You were instructed to destroy everything when you got to your allotted land, but you have decided to do things on your own. And the reason why they were to destroy everything, because at this particular time in history, the Israelites were just babes in their faith. And so therefore, if they were to mingle, if they were to mix with other gods and to mix with other people, they would be confused and they would be contaminated. They would to lose out on the promises that God had for them. And let me put it to you this way. When you look at Jesus and the woman at the well, she went there to draw some water. Now, when you think about wells, most of their wells were 50 to 100 feet deep. And so in order to keep debris and things from falling into the well, they would either have a cover for them, or they had a perimeter around it that would pretty much capture or catch leaves and grass and other debris that may fall into the water and contaminate it. And so when Jesus tells the woman, he says, if you knew who was asking you for water, that you would come and ask me for water, because I have a living water. And see, wells during that time were coming from somewhere else, and most of the water in the well was stagnant, which means that the stagnant water is more prone to contamination than water that is living. And when Jesus says, I'm living, that means it's a continual flow. That means it's hard for me to get contaminated. It's hard for it to be destroyed. So Jesus said, I have a water for you that cannot be contaminated, that cannot be, that it don't need distilling, because it's pure, it's perfect. So Jesus is saying that if you would ask me for water, you wouldn't ever have to come back for water. And so this is what the angel of the Lord was trying, and Joshua was trying to get to tell the people. If you mingle with these people, you become contaminated, and you contaminate the very thing that God is trying to do for you. And so when Joshua died, when Joshua died, these people decided not to listen to Joshua, not to heed the warnings, but they did what was right in their own eyes. And so we move to chapter 3 and Judges, and it says that they became repeat offenders. So they did what they wanted to do. God punished them. God forgave them. And about the time he forgave them, they went back to doing the thing that got them in trouble in the first place. And so in chapter 3, we see where they start talking about where God would give them a judge to help lead them. And so it says that the judge, they would have a judge, and they would do the very thing that got them in trouble. And so God would give them another judge. But in between the transferring of power between one judge and the next, they would do the very same thing. Then they would get a judge, they would straighten up, fly right, the next judge is gone, and between the time they would get another judge, they go back to doing the things that got them in trouble. Here comes judge number three. We fine, we straight, okay, God, not paying attention, go right back to doing the very things that we're doing. Here comes judge number four. All right, we straight. And it was just a continual pattern. Like, they became repeat offenders. When you step outside of God, when you decide to do things on your own, there's only one thing that it leads to, and it leads to self-destruction. But the bad thing is, not only is it self-destructing, it's people-destructing. Because if you finish the book of Judges, you will see that what ends up happening to the children of Israel, they end up in Babylon as captives. They end up taken captive. Now, knowing the history of the Israelites, when you became an adult, or going towards the age of an adult at an early age, especially for young men, around the age of 12 and 13, 14 years old, you pretty much learn the basics of manhood in the Israelite, in their culture. And so you got to understand, they were in Babylon for 70 years. If you read the book of Jeremiah, it says that God told them, don't worry, you're not leaving. They were mad, they were upset, they weren't going anywhere. He said, no, you're not leaving. He says, plant, eat, build, have kids, because you're going to stay here for 70 years. And so the thing about it is that when you self-destruct, it's not only self-destructing, it's people-destructing. And that's why you got to understand that your sins don't only affect you. And a lot of times we often have that kind of attitude, like, oh, I'm not hurting anybody else. This is not going to cause anybody else any pain and things of that nature. That's why as adults, what we do and say around children can have a profound effect on the children that we are around. And then when they get older and they start doing things, and you sit and wonder, where in the world did you get that from? Who taught you that? Who told you that that was right? And when you start, if you were sitting and reflect on your life, you would see that it was you that caused most of the things to happen in these children's life. Yes, they learned some things on their own, but in the book of Judges, it is showing us that life, and we don't live a life separate from each other. No, yeah, me and BJ live at two separate houses, but what he does can affect me, and what I do can affect him. No, we are not blood related, but I can still have a profound effect on his life as much as he can have on mine, because we are connected through the blood of Jesus. And if I make a mistake, if I go out and do something crazy right now, they're not just going to talk about Maurcus Davis. They're not going to say Reverend Davis did this and that. And what they're going to say is, don't he go to First Baptist? Ain't his father Reverend Davis? I used to work with his grandfather. I used to play in the band for his uncle. They are going to run the gamut on me. And so what it's going to cause, it's going to cause a profound effect, not only on myself, but on my family, my church family, my friends. And it's going to cause you to deal with things that you should not have to deal with. And so when you step outside of God, what the book of Joshua and Judges is showing us is that if you self-destruct, there is a very good chance that you're going to cause destruction in somebody else's life. They and these children, it wasn't their fault that they didn't know. Maybe it was a little bit, but it was the responsibility of the elders to tell the children of all the good things that God had done. But in all their time of living, because they decided to mingle with the enemy, they got sidetracked, and they got contaminated. They were cursed, and they decided not. They could not tell the story because they were trying to live out another story. They couldn't tell the story because they forgot about the story. And so it caused not only them much pain and suffering, it caused their children, their grandchildren, their great-grandchildren, their great-great-grandchildren, and their great-great-great grandchildren to be in captivity for 70 plus years. And there was nothing that the children of Israel could do to get out of it. God said to build here, to eat here, to have families here, because you're going to be here for 70 years. But thanks be unto God that they didn't have to stay there. Eventually, God forgave them, and he led them out of Babylon. But as we know in the Bible, we see the repeated pattern of God saving, redeeming. Amen. They live it out for a little while. Amen. And they go back to doing the same thing. That's self-destruction. That's major self-destruction. And if we, as a church, and all the things that are going on in this world, if we're going to fight our own people for speaking the truth, if we're going to beat up on Kim Burrell for speaking the truth, if we're going to, I saw this clip from G.E. Patterson. He says the church has spent too much time trying to convince the world that we are just like them. We are nothing like them. The blood of Jesus separates us from them. And because we have been separated, we have been called to do things differently than the world does it. We have been called to stand out. The Bible says that we are a royal priesthood, a peculiar people, which means that we are strange, we are different. Yes, the world is not going to understand it so long as they don't see Jesus as their Lord and Savior. So we got to stop trying to convince the world that we are just like them. Yes, we make mistakes, but we are covered by the blood of Jesus. So that makes us entirely different from the world. And if we continue to try to say we are like them and try to make the church look like them, the church is not a concert hall. It's a worship place. The church is not the courthouse. The church is not for politics. The church is for worship. And as long as we continue to try to syncretize the church with the world, we are headed for self-destruction. But and as long as we get more of our spouses and our significant others than we do the word of God, we are headed for self-destruction. As long as we get more of, thank God it's Thursday, ABC, how to get away with murder and scandal and all those shows that we love to watch, we are headed for self-destruction. So long as you have more of the world in you than the word of God, you are headed for self-destruction. But thanks be unto God that while we were self-destructive, he gave up his perfection to sit in heaven. He gave it all up. He says that, the Bible says that he became sin. He took on our sin so that we may become like him, so that we may spend eternity with him. God, in a sense, he took on our sins. Sins that we hadn't even committed yet. Sins that we committed now, and sins that we will commit before the day that we die, before the day he comes back. He has died for our sins. But if you don't accept him for to be your Lord and Savior, and that doesn't mean that you come down front and say, Lord, I accept you, and you go and do what the Israelites did and live the same way that you've been living, but you carry it out. He says, then if you don't do those things, then you will continue to self-destruct. And then you will spend eternity in destruction. You will spend eternity away from God. And that is the worst thing, the worst decision that you could ever do. The doors of the church are open. Don't self-destruct. Jesus is waiting for you. They didn't listen. They made mistakes. They did what was right in their own eyes, and it got them in trouble. God gave them ways out. God forgave them over and over and over again. But because God will forgive you doesn't mean that you ought to abuse his forgiveness, because that will lead you on a path to self-destruction. Because when you talk about apostasy in the Bible, that means that your heart has turned from God. So yes, you can be once saved and then decide that you want to live a life outside of God, and you have turned your heart from God. That was King Saul's problem. And when he got to a point where he said that this is no longer our God, he said, your God. And Saul committed apostasy. He turned his back on the Lord. Don't turn your back on the Lord. Yes, you're going to make mistakes, but know that God is going to be with you every step of the way. But if you don't take his hand, you are headed for self-destruction.
Amen.
And doors of the church are open.
Amen.
God is able and willing to get you on that straight and narrow path that leads to life, that he says only a few will find. So if the road is only a few will find, why would you want to go on that crowded road? That road is wide and everybody is trying to get on. Why not take the easy path, the one that not too many are on? It's a clearer path, and it's easy to see Jesus on that path. Doors of the church are open.